So welcome to this third lecture on model selection. So today we shall continue with the study of model selection in the linear situation, that is in the situation where the models are linear. So remember that we are working in the abstract Gaussian white noise framework, where you observe some process y epsilon, which is merely the scalar product between the unknown target f and j, plus some homogeneous noise epsilon times an isonormal process. So this framework is convenient to cover both the infinite dimensional and the finite dimensional frameworks at the same time. In the infinite dimensional case, for instance, you may recover the usual white noise framework just by looking at W of J, which is the integral of J against a Brownian motion. And in finite dimension is just a way of looking at the classical linear Gaussian model, just because the W of J here can be constructed as a scalar product with, of J with a standard dimension, n-dimensional Gaussian vector. Okay, so this is a theorem that we have stated last time. We shall not prove it today because we shall prove it under a more general statement next time. So what does it say this theorem? It says that if the penalty is larger enough, you can correct the Malo-CP criterion in a way that it leads to some selected estimator which has some kind of Oracle inequality which is satisfied. Why do I say that it is some kind of Oracle inequality? It would be an Oracle inequality, an actual Oracle inequality, if here you would find dm epsilon square instead of the penalty, and you would recover the quadratic risk of the least square estimator on the finite dimensional linear model SM. But here it's no longer the case. What you put in the machine, in the algorithm here, you find it at the end in the risk. And this is life. And as we shall see, it's unavoidable. So today we want to look at the application of this theorem to variable selection. So first of all, we look at some collection of linearly independent functions. As we have seen before, this collection of variables can be produced by nature. These variables can be natural quantities that you have observed, in fact, but there can be also things that you have decided to put in the machine just because you have approximation theory in your mind. So this set of functions, for instance, can be part of a wavelet basis or part of the Fourier basis or the whole Fourier basis itself, okay? So now for any subset of capital lambda, we look at the linear span of the functions phi j corresponding to this subset. And we take calligraphic M as a collection of subsets of capital lambda. This is the context of variable selection. And of course, the dimension here, since I have assumed the functions to be linearly independent, the dimension corresponds to the cardinality of the set. So first of all, we look at the ordered variable selection problem. So this problem corresponds to the case where lambda has an order which does matter. Lambda can be finite or infinite, we don't care. So the capital N here can be plus infinity or it can be a finite integer. And the collection of subsets that we are looking at are taken into order. That is, you look at the first integers up to D. So in this case, there is only one model per dimension because the only model with dimension D that you look at is the model which is built with the integers which are taken in order. So in this case, the model selection theorem, when you apply it, you use the consideration that we have studied last time on the weights, and you see that the weights can be chosen in a way that the penalty at the end of the day can be taken as a constant times the cardinality times epsilon squared, and the constant is an arbitrary number which is larger than one. So in this case, I just give some details here. In this case, if you take the weight as a constant alpha that you choose as you like, then the capital sigma, which is the sum of the exponential minus xn, since there is only one model per dimension, this capital sigma is merely the sum of the exponential minus alpha d here. And so, of course, it is less than 1 over exponential alpha minus 1. Okay? So this means that the penalty here has a constraint to be larger than that. And you see immediately that you can take the penalty as k prime epsilon square cardinality of n, just because here alpha is as small as you wish. Okay? Of course, as small, the smaller the alpha, the worse the constant will be here. And intuitively, you don't have the interest to take k prime too close to one. Okay, but nevertheless, the theorem tells you something for all values of k prime larger than one. And the Oracle inequality at the end of the day has the following form here. And C prime, of course, depends only on K prime. Okay. And of course, this means that in this case, up to a constant, the estimator behaves like an oracle. So in this case, you have achieved the goal just by taking the penalty as a quantity which is larger than epsilon squared times the cardinality of M. And of course, this the Mallows case here is taken into account, and this is a situation where Mallows CP is validated. You can use the Mallows penalty and prove that things are working. So an important point here is that intuitively, we see that the value one here has a special role because I come back to the previous slide. The quantity which is there, the C prime here, which depends on K prime, you see that C prime is large if K prime is too close to one. So it seems that something happens at the value one. And indeed, it is the case. More precisely, it can be proved. We shall prove it, but we shall not prove it today. We shall prove it next time. It can be proved that if k prime is strictly smaller than one, then the criterion explodes in the sense that it systematically selects high-dimensional models when epsilon is small. So instead of making the compromise and the good trade-off between the bias and the size of the model, it systematically gives you high-dimensional models. So the criterion explodes in the sense that it gives you stupid values for the selective models with a high risk. Another point is that, as I mentioned to you, in this case, Malo's heuristics is working. Remember that the problem with Malo's heuristics is that it takes into account only the expectation, the value of the expectation of the risk for each given models. So if the list is huge in the sense that there are many models with the same dimension, it can be misleading. But if there is only one model per dimension, it's okay. Malo's CP is working. This is what we have proved, in fact. And more than that, it can be proved with a deeper analysis that this value k prime equal to 2, in this case, corresponds to an optimal choice of the penalty. So you have this minimal choice, which is given to you by the minimal choice, which is the cardinality of M times epsilon, and the optimal choice, which is 2 times cardinality of M times epsilon squared. And this is very interesting that there is a factor 2 here, because in practice, it leads to an interesting way of avoiding the knowledge of the level of noise. In practice, assuming that the level of noise is known is often a problem. So you can use the theory here in the following way. Since the criterion explodes at the value epsilon squared here, then you can see it in your machine. You can see that at some stage, the criterion explodes. And you just multiply it by 2 in order to get the right penalty to use. So this is what is called the slope heuristics, and which helps to use theory in order to avoid the knowledge of epsilon square when you use this criterion in practice. So now we look at the complete variable selection issue. So in the complete variable selection issue, an easy way of choosing and direct way of for choosing the weights is to take as a weight, Xm, which is merely the cardinality of M times log N. So in this case, the sum of the exponential minus Xm will be equal to the sum, It's merely the sum of the binomial coefficients times the exponential of minus D log N. This binomial coefficient appears because it is the number of subsets of cardinality D in a set of cardinality capital N. And of course, you end up with a quantity which is exactly equal to 1 So this is less than E, this is simply less than E. Okay, so you just use that. And in this case,
monsieur, pourriez-vous expliquer pourquoi ça a fait regard à eux?
It's just because when you look at, just take the blackboard. You have the sum. This is the sum of the ND. Exponential of minus d log n. This is what we have. And this is, of course, n to the power, it's n to the power minus d.
Oui.
So this is less than n to the power minus d times one okay, I can't recover it right now. Excuse me, Fanny. I'm not in a very good shape. I did not sleep this night, and the reason is that the grandma of my wife is dead, and I should not be there this morning. So I'm not completely with you. Sorry, but it's an easy calculation. If you do it by yourself, you will recover it easily.
Monsieur, parce que cet exercice est relatif à un exercice pour un examen de concentration d'inégalité. C'est un exercice deux points. Oui, concernant cette conclusion. Mais j'ai raté l'exercice. Oui. OK, je vais demander à mes camarades.
Oui, oui. Désolé, je suis pas, comme je vous le dis, je suis pas en très très bonne forme. J'ai fait l'effort de venir aujourd'hui, mais c'est un peu compliqué pour moi. Voilà.
Ok, merci beaucoup.
If you take this as a penalty here, the risk bound that you get in this case, you can write it in the following way. Since the penalty depends only on the cardinality of the subset here, you can optimize in two steps. Optimize first with respect to all subsets with cardinality D, and then optimize with the cardinality. So if you do this this way, you get as a bias term, the infimum of the bias terms of any possible projection of the true on the model generated by the subsets of cardinality D, okay? And you get as variance terms, in some sense, something which is larger than what you would expect at first. That is, you do not recover epsilon squared times D, but you have this extra log n factor, which comes from the weight. So you see here that this xm is no longer a small correction of the Mallow CP, but it becomes the leading term. Okay. So in this case, it can be shown that Mallow CP does not work at all. It leads to an inconsistent criterion, an exploding criterion. If you use Mallow CP in this case, you will get systematically a selection of high dimensional models.
Best term is defined as what?
This term is defined as what? What do you mean? Here, you get the penalty.
Nekuner, aploke, la formule, oui. Hide. Oui, maintenant c'est bon.
The bias, okay. Okay. Okay, so what you see here is that there is an extra factor, in fact, it's login factor. But if you think about it, it's a rather modest price that we pay as compared to the potential gain that you have in the bias term. Because in the bias term, you are looking at all the possible subsets with cardinality D in the whole collection of variables that you have at hand at the beginning of the story. So this means that you have a potential gain here in the bias, which is huge, and the price that you pay for that is rather modest. So of course, you will gain something if looking at the subsets is more friendly than using the order, for instance. So with the Fourier basis, your gain will not be very huge, but with a wavelet basis, your gain is huge. So it's interesting to see that in the autonomous case, what we have stated now, what we have stated here, does not imply that the system of function is autonomous. Okay, the variables do not need to be autonomous. But if they happen to be orthonormal, then you can completely compute the selected estimator. You can easily see that this estimator corresponds to the Hartz thresholding estimator. So let's see this in details.
Très bien. J'ai trouvé ceci sur le web pour 10. Regardez.
And let's look at that. If you look at the situation if the variables phi j are orthonormal. This is the situation where you can compute the least square estimator explicitly. In this case, it's a projection estimator. This is a computation that we have done last time. So this is a projection estimator. And now if we set T square to be this quantity here, that is the determinist, the part of the penalty which is multiplied by the cardinality of M. Then, if you look at the selection criterion that we have in our hands in this case, it can be written like that. You have minus the norm square of the estimator, okay, plus the penalty. And the penalty here is equal to t square times the cardinality of m. So this sum here, the norm square is the sum of the beta hat j square, okay, so that's clear. But the other part, the penalty, can be written as the sum over this t square, because when you sum the t square for each j, you reconstruct the cardinality of m times t square. So this is exactly the penalty. So this is another way of writing the criterion. And now you see that the best m to choose is the m which is such that this quantity is negative, or more precisely non-positive, for all j. This is the best choice. So the best choice is merely to take those j for which in absolute value beta hat j is greater than t. And this is what is called the hard thresholding estimator. So you see here that the hard thresholding estimator can be interpreted as a penalized least square estimator. This is the idea. The other point is that, again, if you take k to be smaller than one, then you have some troubles. And again, you get some criterion which explodes. And again, in this case, the constraint k larger than one is unavoidable. So another point which will turn to be interesting because of the minimax computation that we shall start today. Another point is that the choice of the weights can be slightly modified. Instead of taking the log n, you can take something which is slightly smaller. By using the following inequality, which is an exercise, and which says that the log of the binomial coefficient is less than d times the log of e times n over d. And if you use that, then you can define as a weight the cardinality of m time one plus some log, which is no longer log n, but which is log of 2n over the cardinality of m. So you see that it is slightly smaller, because when you look at models which are close to the largest models, then this weight is of order the cardinality of m. It is no longer of the order of cardinality of m times the log. So let's see that it works. It works because in this case, the sum of the exponential of minus xm, which you choose xm in this way, you can write it as the sum of the binomial coefficients, again, times the quantity that we have introduced as a definition of xm. And you see that because of the bound on the binomial coefficient that I have mentioned before, your quantity here will be less than this guy. And this guy here comes from the bound on the binomial coefficient. And so there's one here cancelled, and you end up with the log of 2nd minus the log of n over d, and this is merely equal to log 2. And this log 2, the sum of the exponential minus d log 2, is sum that the sum up to infinity of 2 to the power minus d, and which is less than 2. So you see that the sum of the weights in this case is again under control, but with weights which are slightly smaller. And so at the end of the day, the risk bound that you get.
Yeah.
Yes.
Bound dernier, s'il vous plaît. The penalty, c'est quoi? The penalty, c'est quoi?
The penalty has this shape here. So you see that the corrective term, the xm here, is no longer a log n, but you have a log of 2n over the cardinality of m. Okay? So the consequence on the risk bound is that instead of log n, as before, you get, instead of log n, you get something which is slightly nicer, which is log of n over d, 2n over d, in fact. So you see that if d is n over 8, let's say, here you see that you get a constant, and this is no longer a log n. Okay? And nevertheless, this is interesting because it's exactly the order of magnitude of the minimax risk over the union of the models generated by all the subsets with cardinality equal to D. And this is something that we shall prove not today, but next time. And again, this leads to a computable estimator because with this penalty here, you can modify the arguments that we have used before. Your criterion writes like this. You still have this sum of minus beta hat j square as before, and plus, before we had the cardinality of m times a constant. Here we have the quantity which still depends on the cardinality of m. But nevertheless, you can optimize this criterion by proceeding in two steps. You may optimize over the subsets with cardinality D and then optimize over D. If you optimize over the subsets with cardinality D, obviously this quantity here does not change. It is exactly equal to the same quantity for all this M. So the best M here is to put this beta J square into order and take the largest. So you put this beta J square into order. And the first step optimization leads to take the largest one among the D first one. So somebody has come here. So we have to say welcome. Okay. And so you end up with an optimization now over D. And of course, this is an easy optimization to perform in a machine. Okay.
Monsieur, qu'est-ce que c'est? Beta chapeau avec un indicatrice J avec un parenthèse J.
This guy?
Oui, c'est quoi?
Ce sont les coefficients qui sont mis par ordre. Je reviens à... Tac.
Expliquez en français, s'il vous plaît.
Oui, c'est ce que je fais. Donc, tu prends les coefficients empiriques au carré et tu les ranges du plus grand jusqu'au plus petit.
Beta, c'est dans Rn ou dans R?
Beta chapeau J, ici, c'est un nombre. Hein.
Nombre.
C'est dans R.
Oui.
Donc, beta chapeau J au carré, c'est un nombre positif.
Oui.
Et ces nombres positifs-là, tu vas les ranger. Pourquoi tu les ranges? Parce que l'optimisation du critère, tu la réalises en deux temps. Tu optimises d'abord ton critère avec tous les sous-ensembles de cardinal égal à D. Et si tu prends tous les sous-ensembles de cardinal égal à D, cette quantité-là, elle ne bouge pas. Elle est égale à D fois le L rond de D.
Oui, ok.
Et donc, la seule partie qui bouge, c'est cette partie-là. Et cette partie-là, pour la rendre la plus petite possible, il faut que tu rendes cette partie-là sans le moins, le plus grand possible. Et pour la rendre la plus grande possible, eh ben, tu prends les D plus grands coefficients.
D plus grands
coefficients.
Oh, coefficients.
Okay. Là, tu as rangé tous tes coefficients au carré ici et tu prends les D plus grands coefficients au carré.
Ok. Ok, merci.
So at the end, this leads to an optimization over a set of integers here. So you can put it in a machine and you get something which is not as explicit as the Haas thresholding estimator, but still it's computable. For the change point detection, it's exactly the same combinatorial considerations that I do not reproduce here, but it is, you have exactly the same things that, as we have described before. So now I would like to turn to another point of view, which is directly linked to the previous one, but which will lead us to look at lower bounds instead of upper bounds in order to check that the methods that we have introduced are optimal in the minimax sense. So let me explain to you what I have in mind. The point is that we have used a notion of model selection, which does not require at all that the target belongs to any of the models. The risk bounds that we get are completely universal. They say that whatever the target, you have a result by using your selection criterion. So this means that despite of the fact that you use linear models, for instance, you can expect to get sensitive results in a non-parametric universe. You have used models with finite dimension, but nevertheless, since the target can be arbitrary, it does not require that the target belongs to the collection of models, then it may happen that if the target is not too far from a model with a reasonable dimension, you get some very sensitive result. So this is what I want to illustrate now. And the issue that we want to address is to check that the resulting value, when the true belongs to ellipsoids, for instance, will be of optimal order. This is the issue that you want to address today. So I recall you the definition of an ellipsoid. And now I just would like to refresh your mind and my mind by looking at what happens when we put the variables into order, and we look at the ordered variable selection. So what can we collect in this case as a result and see the performance on some ellipsoid? So let's do that explicitly. So we look at ordered variable selection. So I remind you that it amounts to look at the variables into order, but here, I would like to stress on the fact that in the very definition of an ellipsoid, the order does matter because you have this assumption that the sequence size j is non-increasing. So this means that the order on the phi j, on the phi j does matter for an ellipsoid. So this is not stupid at all to look at.
Je dois noter la définition maintenant pour vous montrer.
Tu l'as déjà la définition, c'est juste un rappel. Hein. On l'a déjà vu la définition de l'ellipsoïde.
Je voudrais noter maintenant.
OK.
CG, c'est non-decreasing, c'est ça?
Oui, oui.
Non-increasing.
Non-increasing.
Merci.
OK, so...
Tendant vers zéro.
Oui. Décroissant tendant vers zéro. So we look at the order variable selection. In this case, we have seen that the Malow's penalty makes the job. You can take the Malow's penalty. And in this case, we have also seen that the selected estimator behaves as an oracle. This is something that we have seen. Okay. So So at this stage, I put expectation here with the I mentioned explicitly that the expectation depends on the true F, because I shall play with many F at the same time. So it's important to make sure that we have in mind that the distribution depends on F here. Okay, so I just give you here the resulting bound now, when the true depends on the ellipsoid. So I pretend that in this case, the oracle inequality that we have here implies that if the true happens to be in some ellipsoid, uniformly over the ellipsoid, the risk is under control. So let's see that. Let's see that the proof is very simple. This is just because the bias term when F belongs to the ellipsoid is merely the tail of the series of the beta j square starting from d plus one. Okay, so this series, I can write it in a different way. I can write it as the sum of the beta j square over cj square times cj square. And of course, since their cj square are all with j larger than d plus one, and the sequence is non-increasing, I can bound this guy by cd plus one square. But doing this, I put it in front of the sum, and the sum is itself smaller than the total sum, and the total sum is less than one because you belong to the ellipsoid. So at the end, it bounds you the bias term by cd plus one square. Okay. So this means that at the end of the day, your risk of the selected estimator is under control by some constant C prime, which does not depend on anything, times the infimum over D of D epsilon square plus CD plus one square. And of course, since this C prime does not depend on anything, you can put a sup here, and this gives you the announced result. So I just show you again the slide here and the bound. You see that you have a control on the maximal risk over the ellipsoid. And this is true for all ellipsoids. So look, there is something which is strong here, because I have started with a model selection criterion on linear models. Okay, and at the end of the day, I discover that my estimator, my selected estimator, has a performance over all ellipsoids at the same time, and these ellipsoids are very different kinds, because I did not say to my procedure that I would work with an ellipsoid with a sequence which is CJ. The sequence CJ is completely unknown. But this, despite of the fact that the sequence CJ is unknown, I am able to estimate it with a quality which adapts to the CJ. So this is the adaptation effect in some sense.
Pourquoi monter la dernière phrase de transparent dernier, merci.
Since this bound holds uniformly with respect to F, the result follows, you can take the soup, okay?
Okay.
And so precisely, this is the effect that you want to study now. This is what we call adaptation. That is, we want to prove that the bound that we have made appear, that is the maximal risk over the ellipsoid, you cannot beat it. That is, right now, we shall prove that it is possible to lower bound the maximal risk over an ellipsoid for any estimator with a quantity which looks like what we have found, except that it is the soup of d epsilon square infimum with cd square. But it's an easy exercise to see that this, yes.
Je n'ai pas abandonné la proposition, c'est très important pour moi. Ok, c'est bon.
Ok, so just I take the blackboard just to tell you that in fact, we have two different quantities. We have the soup of d epsilon square, infimum cd square, and you have the infimum of d epsilon square plus cd plus one square. And I pretend that these two quantities are the same in the sense that the ratio between the two lies between, let's say, 4 1/4, okay? And this is the case if you look at the non-degenerate ellipsoid, that is when you look at C1 larger than epsilon. So there's two quantities as are of the same order. Why? Because in the non-degenerate case like that, roughly speaking, the d where this infimum is achieved is the same as the d where this supremum is achieved. This is the d for which cd square here is of order of d epsilon square, heuristically. Okay? And so if they are of the same order, then of course this infimum is the same of the same order as the supremum. This is the same, okay? So this is an exercise. You have to look at it carefully, but this works. And this means that what we have found as an upper bound for the selected estimator corresponds to what you can prove to be a lower bound for the min-max risk. What is called the min-max risk is the minimum of the maximal risks minimum taken over all the possible estimators. So this is a very strong result. This means that this estimator has what is called an adaptation property. That is, despite of the fact that you do not say to the estimator that you are working in such ellipsoid, it is able to achieve the minimax risk over this ellipsoid. This is what is called the adaptation property in the minimax sense. Okay, it's a good point to stop and take a coffee break, and we start again in 5 or 10 minutes. So my purpose now is double in some sense. I would like to introduce you some general tools which can be used to build minimax lower bounds. And then we shall use the general tools to achieve the goal to prove that the selected estimator on ordered, in the context of ordered variable selection, is optimal in the minimax sense on all the ellipsoids. So the purpose of the game is first to introduce general tools for bounding the minimax risk from below, first, and second, to use it to compute the minimax risk on the ellipsoid. So one general tool, which is very nice, as you will see, is a lemma, which is due to Lucien Birger. And the lemma proved by Lucien is a structural lemma, and which allows to, which can be used for bounding the minimax risk in a very various situation. So this is an abstract lemma. You take some family of probabilities, and you take some collection of disjoint measurable sets, and you look at the minimum of the probabilities of these measurable sets. Then, provided that the number of probabilities times this minimal penalty is larger than one, you have an implicit control on this minimum penalty by the mean of the relative entropies of the PIs with respect to P null, playing a special role here. And this H function, which appears and which gives you the implicit relationship inequality, is an H function that we know. It's the Legendre dual of the log moment generating function of the Bernoulli distribution with parameter P. This means that, more concretely, HP of A is merely the soup of lambda A minus phi P of lambda being the log of the moment generating function of the Bernoulli variable with parameter P. So this is a statement. It can look like an obscure statement, but the corollary is maybe more clear. It gives you an upper bound, an explicit upper bound this time on the minimal penalty, minimal probabilities, excuse me. So this is the same assumption as in the lemma, but this time you have an explicit control by the mean of the relative entropies over the log of the number of probabilities. So here, the main point is that we see how the number of probabilities do influence the quality of multitests. You have a set of probabilities, and you want to test among these probabilities. And here you have a universal control on the errors. Okay, this is the idea of Birger's lemma. We shall see afterwards how to use it to lower bound the risk. So first of all, I would like to show you the proofs of Birger's lemma and of its corollary. So I go to the blackboard and show you the proof. So as you will see, the proof is based on tools that we have studied together, that is tools coming from information theory. So the proof of Birger's lemma. As you may remember, you have seen that a consequence of the duality formula on entropy is that you can write the log of the moment generating function of the variable z as the soup over those probabilities q, which are absolutely continuous with respect to p, of lambda expectation of z under q minus the relative entropy of q with respect to p. So you remember that. You may remember that. So we use it with z being the indicator function of the event AI, and Q being equal to PI. If PI is not absolutely continuous with respect to P null, then the formula is true because the relative entropy is plus infinity. So you may always bound something by plus infinity. So there is nothing to prove. Otherwise, you can use it. And this is what you get. And so this means that when you compute now the log of a moment generating function, then what it gives you is that the lambda times pi of ai, this corresponds to that guy here, minus the log of the moment generating function of the indicator function under the Bernoulli variable with parameter p of ai. So I just denote p null by p to make it shorter. And this is less than the relative entropy of pi with respect to p. Okay. And so this is true, of course, for all I between 1 and capital N. And I can take the mean here. And we end up with lambda times 1 over n, the sum of the pi of ai, minus 1 over n, the sum of phi sub p of ai of lambda, less than d bar, where d bar is the mean of the relative entropies of pi with respect to p null. Okay, so now the trick is that when you look at the function, p gives minus phi p of lambda, lambda being non-negative here, then it is easy to check that it is a convex function. So, of course, when you look at the minimum of the probabilities, it is always less than the mean. So you get that A times lambda, this implies that A times lambda minus phi sub the mean of the P of AI of lambda is less than D bar. Here, I have replaced the mean of the phi of P AI by phi sub the mean. So this is a convexity argument which allows to do that. And now I use the fact that the AI are disjoint to ensure that 1 over n, the sum of the p of ai is less than 1 minus p of n null over n, and which is also less than 1 minus a over a. Okay, and now I use the monotonicity of the function phi p of lambda as a function of p to conclude that a times lambda minus phi sub 1 minus a over n of lambda is less than d bar. And now, since it holds for all positive values of lambda, we may optimize it holds true for the slope . This gives you the result. This is the end of the proof of Birger's lemma. Now for the proof of the corollary. The difficulty here is to pseudo-inverse this H function. So the trick is to use the fact that we can simplify this H function by comparing it with the corresponding quantity for the Poisson distribution. And this has a name. This is Bennett's inequality. So we use, for the corollary, we use Bennett's evaluation for the log moment generating function of a bounded variable, which is here an indicator function. And we use it for comparing the HP function with the corresponding function for the Poisson. So if you use that, if you use Bennett, what you get is that HP of A is larger than P times H of A over P minus 1 where H is the function that you know to be the dual of the log moment generating function of a Poisson variable with parameter 1 and which is centered. So this is by essence Bennett here. And so at the end of the day, this gives you that HP of A is larger than A times the log of A over P minus 1 plus P. And this is also larger than A log of A over AP. So this means here that we have kept this part, and we have decided that we did not have the use of this one. So we let it down in some sense, and we just keep this evaluation here. And now you see that if you define kappa as being equal to 2e over 2e plus 1, you see that A times the log of n A over E1 minus A. So we have this in our pocket here, okay? And we use now Birger's lemma. But plug in this quantity instead of HP. So this gives you the fact that A times the log of NA E multiplied by 1 minus A is less than D bar. This is Birger's lemma, the consequence by putting this quantity instead of HP. And now it's almost finished because if A is larger than kappa, then N A over E times 1 minus A will be larger than 2 times N. And this means that A times log of 2n is smaller than d bar. And since n is larger than 1, this gives you that A times log of n plus 1 is less than d bar. And this is the end of the proof of the corollary. Okay, so let's go back to the slides. So we have this corollary now in our pocket. And now it's time to use it to derive some kind of general lemma or proposition to lower bound the risk in a subset of the Hilbert space in the white noise model. So there is some unavoidable step which amounts to compute the relative entropies between two white noise experiments. That is, you change here the true, what is the effect and what is the computation of the relative entropy. So this is done in the following proposition that we shall prove next time, because next time we shall use this proposition to prove the general nonlinear model selection theorem. So this is something that I postpone and we shall prove it next time. So the proposition is as follows. The relative entropies between two experiments is given by epsilon to the power minus 2 over 2 times the distance square between the two values, f and j. Okay, so this is an easy computation in some sense, easy to interpret, that is, up to some scaling factor, the relative entropy is proportional to the distance square between the two. So now, concretely, when you want to lower bound Excuse me, there's something missing here, I think. I have a slide which is missing. Okay. Fine. So this is not a problem. I shall just write it on the blackboard. I have forgotten to put a slide. Okay, so this leads to a general proposition that I have not put on the slide, but I write it on the blackboard. So the proposition is as follows. We take some subset of the Hilbert space, and we want to lower bound the risk over this subset. How can we do that? We can do that by taking some finite subset of T. And we look at two different quantities, the width, which is the minimal value of the distance between points in C calligraphic here. This is the width of the set C here. And you take also the diameter. So this time, this is the soup. Excuse me, the soup over F and F prime belonging to C of the distance between these guys. Okay, so if you look now at the infimum over all the possible estimators of the soup over F belonging to T of the risk of the estimator square, then it is larger than the width over 4 times 1 minus kappa. Kappa is this very constant which appears in the corollary of Birger's lemma. And this is true provided that the diameter delta square is less than 2 epsilon square times the log of the cardinality, excuse me, of C. This is the proposition. So what does it mean? Imagine that capital T here is a compact subset of capital H. So to measure the size of a compact subset, what are you doing? You are a possibility is to measure its size by counting the number of balls that you can use, that you have to use, excuse me, to cover the set T. To build a covering of T is the same as looking at a maximal net. A net is a set of points which are separated by a certain quantity. So here, if you say that the minimal width that the minimal distance between the different points is delta. This means that you have a delta net here. If you take a maximal delta net, this will be a covering, this will provide you a covering of T. So the idea here is to take a net, but you do not take any net. You take a net for which you have a certain control for the diameter. So at the end of the day, the idea is to use this proposition to build a lower bound for the risk by constructing some nets such that the diameter and the width of the net will be of the same order of magnitude. This is the way we shall use this proposition. So let's see how to prove it. The proof is not that complicated. So first of all, we have a small difficulty to overcome, which is that you see here that the structure which is involved is C, but the soup here is taken over the whole set capital T here, okay? So this means that we have an effort to make to pass from T to C. So of course, it goes in the right direction in the sense that T is larger than C, so the soup over capital T is larger than the soup over C, that's clear. But here, what is less clear is that the estimator F tilde here does not know C, that is, it's not you do not have the right to assume that F tilde has values which are taken in C. So there is a small difficulty here to see that we can first pass from the situation where we are working anywhere at the situation where we are working in C. So this is the first step in some sense. So first step, pass from T to C and from F tilde anywhere to F tilde with values in C. This is the first step. So this is an easy argument. This is a projection argument. So how to do that? If you start from F tilde being any estimator, then you may build an estimator F tilde C, so an estimator which will take its values in C, just by defining F tilde C, you define it as the minimum, as the argmin, excuse me, among J belonging to C of F tilde minus J. So now, if you look at F minus F tilde C, if you know that F belongs to C, you may upper bound this by F minus F tilde plus F tilde minus F tilde si. But by definition, this F tilde C is the closest point to F tilde in C. So if F belongs to C itself, it means that this is less than F tilde minus F. So this means that this guy here is less than 2 times F minus F tilde. So this means that essentially you cannot get a much worse estimator by assuming that it takes its values in C if you know in advance that F belongs to C. This is the idea. So this means that the infimum over F tilde of the soup F belonging to T of the quadratic risk here of F tilde is larger than 1/4 times the same quantity, but here assuming that F tilde takes its values in C and the supremum being taken with F belonging to C. Okay, so now if we look at what happens here, when you know that the F tilde belongs to C, this means that if you take delta as in the proposition, that is delta, this is the width of C, you see that this distance square is always greater than delta square because you have points which are in C. And furthermore, you can, of course, say that sometimes you pay zero if F tilde happens to be equal to F. So this means that the supremum here. So this means that if F tilde takes its values in C, you get that the supremum of this risk here is always larger than delta square over 4, which comes from the width, times the soup of the probabilities that F is different from F tilde. You pay delta, but you do not pay anything if F is equal to F tilde. So you have delta square over 4 times the soup of the probability that F is different from F tilde. And this, of course, makes you the link with Berger's lemma, because this soup of probabilities is of course equal to 1 minus the minimum of the probabilities that f is equal to f tilde. And you see now this the structure appearing as in Bierges lemma. You have disjoint events here, and you take the probability of this disjoint events under various values of f. Okay. So now it's time to combine this evaluation with the corollary of Bierges lemma. We see that you may always look at the relative entropies between the white noise experiments. If you take two different points, you know that the soup of these quantities here will be equal to epsilon to the power minus square over 2 times delta square, just because this is the computation of the relative entropy that you have seen. It is up to the scaling factor, the distance square between the points. So this makes you the delta square appear here. And if this quantity is under control by the constant kappa coming from the corollary times the log of the cardinality of C, then the minimal probabilities that f is different from f tilde is under control by kappa, because this minimal penalty is controlled by kappa inf the soup, excuse me, with this quantity here divided by the log. So if you know that this quantity divided by the log is less than kappa, the soup between the two quantities is kappa. So of course, this means that coming back to the control of the supremum of the minimax risk, this means that the infimum over f tilde or the supremum over f belonging to t of the expectation of f minus f tilde square is larger than delta square over 4 that we had before, times 1 minus the minimal probability, and this is here that we use this control with 1 minus kappa. And this holds true if delta square is less than 2 epsilon square kappa log cardinality. Okay, and this is the proposition, at least I hope so. Yes. This is a proposition. So now we have this proposition, and we shall use it now to produce the lower bound on the ellipsoid that was mentioning to you. And to do that, we shall use hypercubes. So let me explain to you what are hypercubes. We We intend to use this lower bound on hypercubes. So what I call a hypercube, it's the following structure. We take CD of R, which is the set of R times the sum of theta j, phi j, and nd. And theta j belonging to 0, 1. And we shall play with theta belonging to 0, 1 to the power d. This is the plane hypercube, and also with the discrete hypercube, that is theta belonging to 0, 1 to the power d. We shall play with the two things. So if you look at this carefully, when you look at two different points here that I can denote by f theta, maybe. If I look at the distance square between f theta and f theta prime, this distance square is merely r square times the distance square between theta and theta prime. So if you are in the discrete hypercube, if theta belongs to 0, 1 to the power d, and theta prime the same. If you restrict yourself to the discrete hypercube, you get here r squared times the Hamming distance, that is the number of coordinates of theta, which are different from the coordinates of theta prime. And we are almost done here. This discrete hypercube is almost the C that we want to use. There is a small problem here, which is that you see the distance, the Hamming distance is in mean. If I put the uniform distribution on the discrete hypercube, in mean, the Hamming distance is d over 2. But some points are at distance 1, while some points at a distance d. So if we want a good net will be points with distance which are of the same magnitude. And so this is the role of the Varshamov-Gilbert lemma that we shall see right now, to prove that in the discrete hypercubes, there are many points which are at a distance which are of order magnitude d. Okay, this is what we want to do now, and this will be proved by a probabilistic argument. So let's come back to the slides and the statement of this lemma. So to use the proposition that you have just proved, we shall use it on a discrete hypercube. And we extract, in fact, some subset of the discrete hypercube, and this will be definitely our net. So this subset will have the property that the distance between the points are separated within a distance which is of order d over 2. There is a small constant here that we shall adapt at the end. And by the way, in terms of log cardinality, the log cardinality of this set is also of order d, as the whole set. The whole set has a cardinality which is of order D. It's exactly equal to D times log 2. Okay, so here you do not have log 2, of course, but you have another constant, which is rho over 2. And this rho over 2, this rho is related to alpha with this explicit formula. And we shall use it concretely with alpha equal to 1/2. And in this case, rho is larger than 1/4. This is the way we shall use it concretely. So let's see the proof of the Varshamov-Gilbert lemma. As I mentioned to you, this is a probabilistic argument that we shall use. So first of all, we defined capital theta as a maximal set satisfying the separation property. So this is a usual way to build a covering. You take points which are separated by a certain quantity, and you take a maximal set of points of this kind. And then, of course, since you cannot add a point to this set of points and stay separated, this means that you get a covering. So this means that the balls in Hamming distance, which have center the points of theta and radius 1 minus alpha d over 2, these balls are covering the hypercube because you took a maximal set. And now the trick is that if you use the uniform distribution on 0, 1 to the power d, this amounts to say that you have a Bernoulli scheme with symmetric Bernoullis, parameter 1/2, and you have D independent Bernoulli variables with parameter 1/2, which are the coordinates in the hypercubes. And so if you look at SD, which follows a binomial distribution with parameter d and 1/2. When you normalize the ball the cardinality of the ball with center a point in capital theta, but in fact any point, and which has radius 1 minus alpha d over 2. Then all these balls have the same cardinality, which is merely equal to the probability that the binomial is less than 1 minus alpha d over 2. Why is it so? It is so because when you look at the Hamming distance between the points, If theta here is given, and you imagine that theta prime is taken at random under the uniform, excuse me, this is capital D here, is taken at random under the uniform distribution on the hypercube, this quantity here has a binomial distribution. So the probability that this distance is less than a certain quantity, which is 1 minus alpha d over 2 here, is related to the cardinality of the ball just by normalizing by 2 to the power minus d in the one hand, and on the other hand, it is linked to this binomial probability. Okay? So this is a nice probabilistic argument, which allows us to conclude now, because if we come back to the proof, this means that the cardinality of theta now, because of the covering argument, implies that the cardinality of theta has to be larger than 1 over this very probability that we have seen appear, that is 1 over the probability that SD is less than 1 minus alpha d over 2. But now, by symmetry, we know that this probability is also the same as the probability that SD is larger than 1 plus alpha d over 2. And we know by Chernoff's inequality that this is less than the exponential of minus d and the h one half function that we have seen before, because this is symmetric. This is a symmetric Bernoulli computed at 1 plus alpha over 2. And this is exactly equal to exponential minus d rho. And so when you inverse this thing here, this implies that the cardinality of theta is less than the exponential of plus d rho. Is greater, excuse me. To erase this, is larger than this, because this is 1 over this quantity, so this is larger than exponential d rho. So in terms of log cardinality, it is greater than rho times d. And the proof of the Warshawsky-Gilbert's lemma is completed. Okay, so now the consequence for a plane hypercube in the Hilbert space is as follows. You have a lower bound for the maximal risk of any estimator on a plane hypercube, which is given by this quantity, some absolute constant kappa zero times R infimum with epsilon squared times d. What is the meaning of this result? This is clear. If the radius r is large, this means that the infimum between the two is epsilon. So this means that estimating in a large in a big enough hypercube, let's say, in a big hypercube, estimating in a big hypercube, you have to pay the same price as estimating in the whole linear space. In the whole linear space, the risk is d epsilon squared. And so you pay up to constant, of course, as much if r is larger than epsilon. But on the contrary, if r is less than epsilon, it's the size of the hypercube which plays a role, and you pay r squared times d. So this is the lesson that we learned from this proposition. So the proof of the proposition now. Let's go back to the blackboard. So minimax risk on the hypercube. So we use Varchamov-Gilbert lemma. And we define more precisely our C. We take as our C the collection of the F theta with theta belonging to capital theta. That is, we look at the R sum of theta j phi j points with theta, which belongs to the special set capital theta, which comes from Varchamov-Gilbert. So of course, the points in C are separated with a quantity which is equal to R times d over 2. This is a d over 4, excuse me. It's incorrect, excuse me. The distance squared between the points are like that, excuse me. So when I look at f theta minus s theta prime square, there's points with theta different from theta prime. These points are separated by r square, this is clear, times the Hamming distance, and the Hamming distance is larger than d over 4. So in terms of distance square, they are separated by r square d over 4. When theta and theta prime belong to capital theta. So this means now that when you use our general proposition, the general proposition to build a low bound of the minimax risk, ensure that whatever the estimator F tilde, the supremum over F in our plane hypercube will be of the quadratic risk, will be larger than R square D over 4 times 1/4 here. 1/4 comes from the statement of the theorem. R squared d over 4 comes from the width. times 1 minus kappa. And this is true provided that the statement on the diameter holds true. But the statement on the diameter holds true if epsilon to the power minus 2 over 2, the diameter square, but the diameter square is always less than d r square because you are in the discrete structure here. In the discrete structure, the distance, the maximal distance in Hamming distance is at most d. So the diameter in Hamming distance is at most d, and you have the scale parameter, which is r square. And you have to ensure that this is less than kappa d over 8. This comes from Varshamov-Gisbert's lemma with alpha equal to 1/2. And so rho is equal to 1/4, something like that. Okay, so at the end of the day, this tells you that this result was true whenever r is not too large, that is, r is less than epsilon times the square root of kappa over 2. So if this is true, So if R is not too large, then we have as a lower bound for the minimax risk, the quantity which is R square D over 16 times 1 minus kappa. So this is okay, but in this case. But remember that our lower bound says something which is slightly different. We want kappa zero times r infimum epsilon square. So how can we produce this? But just have to remember that we have a plane hypercube. So this means that the minimax risk is larger if the hypercube is bigger. And we can use this monotonicity. Because now we can say something like that. If I know that this result holds true when r is less than this quantity, if r is larger than this quantity, then the minimax risk is larger than the value that I get at the border, that is for this quantity at the border. And we get qualitatively the same quantity as before, that is this, but with epsilon square instead of r square. So this means that at the end of the day, we get this result by this monotonicity argument. Okay, so the proposition on the hypercube is proved. And now the last step is to pass from the hypercube to the ellipsoid. And this is the easiest step, in fact. We take a hypercube included in the ellipsoid, and which is as large as possible. So this is easy. If you want the constraint on the ellipsoid to be fulfilled, so you want that a guy in the hypercube belongs to the ellipsoid, this means that you have to put a constraint on R, and the constraint on R is that dr square over cd square is less than one. If you have this, then the hypercube is included in the ellipsoid. Just simple. And of course, when you see this, if you want to take the hypercube as large as possible, you choose R equal to the largest quantity which is allowed, that is R equal to CD over square root of D. And the lower bound that you get on this hypercube is kappa zero times CD over square root of D, infimum of epsilon square times D. And this is exactly equal to the kappa zero CD square infimum epsilon square times D that was announced. Because of course now, since you get this for all D, the ellipsoid contains all these upper cubes, and so the risk is larger than the soup of these quantities, and you get the lower bound that was announced. This means that the minimax risk over the ellipsoid greater than kappa zero times the soup over D of D epsilon square infimum with CD square. And this is the result. Okay, so this is the end of today's lecture. Next time, we shall do some more lower bounds, shall be some more lower bounds from the minimax perspective. And after that, we shall prove the general model selection theorem in the Gaussian framework for models which are not necessarily linear, and see what are the consequences for procedures like regularizations, for instance. So thank you for attention and see you next week, I hope, in good shape, I hope. So stay safe. See you.